Making a life worth living and retirement worth having is really about the people in our lives and how we handle ourselves in many situations. There are times when a man has to be rough with others because they're being rude or they're being difficult or they're being immature, like in children who are unattended and unmanned at a public restaurant. Their parents literally let them go run amok in the early evening hours, or they're waywardly boys who do it on their own without someone there, or they're latchkey kids. And as a part of that, there's no one in the community, no surrounding men and women to look after them. That's sort of a problem in today's world, that young men are being reared by other young men. And these other young men are not necessarily in the house of the Lord. Now, what do I mean by that? What I practically mean by that is that there are people who help people to go on in life. The other day I was sitting in a McDonald's that I really like because it's got such good staff and actually good hot food most of the time and pretty good service. There's also an easy place to sit, and nobody messes around with you. If you want to sit there all day and work, they don't bother you at all. You just keep buying food, you keep eating there like a good customer, and everybody's okay with you. And that's a wonderful type of place. You want a place like that where people are known by their name, or they know the staff literally by their name, and that is a good place to be. Now, when we talk about these things, it's important to understand customer service is in every moment of time that someone serves on behalf of a large corporation. That is something that young employees don't understand. They're not trained well is sort of the problem. They're trained in the basics of providing food. They're trained in the basics of standing someplace and looking like a moron when there's nobody there to try and serve someone who's not even present. And that's something we'll talk about a little later. But in truth, when we're looking at how do we make sure that young men understand how to win in life, we have to put them with people who understand how to win. My point is that I was sitting there late in the early evening hours having some food, continuing to work on my projects, and found an older man there with younger teenage kind of 20-something boys and then a younger boy. He started to impress upon that young boy that he should do things and be certain ways, and I thought, who is this man? Is he a pastor? Is he a owner of a company that employs these young people? Is he just a guy who picks up young men and tries to mentor them in some way? It was hard to tell. Most of the time, a pastor is pretty clear of who he is. He doesn't use foul language, he doesn't insult people, and he doesn't allow men to talk about women in the way in which those men were talking about girls, and talking about fighting, and talking about all these things. That man was not a peacekeeper, he was just saying, stay out of it. But that's good, but that's not how we create men who create a love of the Lord, or how we create peace in this world. Now, when I talk like this, people don't necessarily like it, because I was once a marketing man. I did a lot of things in my community, I helped people to meet one another on a regular basis, and while we might not have produced really large 100-people events all the time, we certainly had several of those that were 50-60 seaters. But the reality is people made good connections from those events. There was talk time, there was interaction time, there was fellowship time. Now I'm seated right now in a Panera because I like Panera food for breakfast, and I used to come here almost every single day when I had a business and a practice that afforded it. I literally would take my family off to their prospective schooling, and then I would go to Panera, and I would sit there, and I'd work, and I'd run into people from my business community, and we'd have conversations. But now I'm sitting here today alone, and I'm sitting outside of a table of men who are a part of a fellowship. They literally are neighborhood neighbors, I guess. And one man decided to lead them, and they've been doing this ever since literally the Panera's been inception. Well, for as far as I remember, this Panera's been here at least 7 years, possibly 10. It's hard to say, but definitely 7. And this man's leading these folks in fellowship. And I think how wonderful that these men have stayed committed to each other, the importance of having relationships, the importance of staying vital with each other, the importance of keeping in track on each one another's families. And that's what fellowship is about. You see, practically, when a person literally goes into a church setting, they're looking for one thing. Not only a love of God and a way to learn more about the Lord and the heavenly opportunities that exist for people who love God, but they're also looking for fellowship with their own age demographics practically, or the opportunity to meet someone if they're single, to move on in life, to have a partner in life like we're supposed to, according to the Bible and according to Genesis and all that. But we also have people in the world who don't get that little expectation, that they literally think it's a one-off miss that someone decided to show up, be a part of their little service, and then go on. They don't take time to say, listen, we'd love to get your contact information if you're okay with that. Some people will promise to make some sort of help, but then they'll force it on to the pastor that he can provide that intermediary assistance, and maybe the pastor's not the right fit for the guest. You see, in life we have multiple pastors at larger churches. at smaller churches with lots of people, they may not have that ability because they haven't figured out how to work out the marketing of the organization to the point that they have enough tithing to allow for more people. But here's what I know from having once gone to a church called Every Nation, which I don't think is called that anymore, but used to be the Pro Footballers Church in our community. Literally, there was pro basketball players who led the congregation. There was actually professional football players from the Colts who attended, and there were other people there. That they had about four pastors, and each pastor had a different strength. One pastor was a great orator, another pastor was a great minister, another pastor was a great liaison, and so on and so forth. And that's how staffs should be handled. But also, there's a part of it that is a part of customer service, that literally in life, we have to know who fits who. We have to really think about, in our lifetime, what did we feel when we were with that individual? Did we feel loved? Did we feel honored? Did we feel put in a place of importance? Did the person literally greet us every single time with a hug? Or were there some professional codes of ethics, or perhaps some morals that had to be set aside because of people being in relationships with others that have different cultural contexts that would not allow a person to do certain things that they might naturally do because they're being honorary to their relationships that they're in, their love relationships, their divorce relationships, or whatever the heck it may be. Now, in life, some people do go through divorce. They go through divorce because practically they didn't exactly choose the right person. And that's hard to say because people often choose on lust, they choose on looks, they choose on physicalities, they choose on how it makes them feel to be with that person, how they feel other people will look at them by being with that person. But they're not always looking at how does the Lord think about what you're doing? How does God feel about the choice you made? Did you choose based on the Lord's principles of a man that will honor you all the days of your life? Or have you chosen based on physicalities that will fade with time, that could stray because of every man is usually looking for something else at some point in his life? And that's part of manhood. You see, manhood is something that people are not really teaching to young boys. I've seen it time and time again, and I've had the privilege of being a mentor of sorts in young men's lives in my Japanese language program, that when they seemed a little off-putting in their way, I kind of put them back in their place and say, look, in life you have a moment in time to make relationships. You have to become more social in order to have networking opportunities, in order to have a job, in order to become presidents of companies. You need to know how to talk to people, lead them, mentor them, and all that. That sort of puts some men who are very quiet and very alone in their life into a different mindset. It allowed them to think that they had all the power in the world to change their life, to become more outgoing, to be more of a role model to people, and to be an honorary man. And I told them, if you want to be a little crap in life, go ahead. But you won't have a lot of people looking after you when you're old and gray. And that's something they hadn't really thought about because they were so young in their mindset, so young in their life, that they couldn't even fathom what it would be like in their older ages. Here's what I know from watching my father go through his transition literally towards heaven, is that when he went towards heaven, he was literally left alone all the time. They are paid to look after several people at a time in these facilities where independent living is not possible anymore. They literally will allow that person to play that little bell of, please come and help me, please come and help me, almost for 20, 30 minutes, an hour maybe, before someone will ever show up and help them. Practically, because they have lots of job duties, but also because they feel the power of saying no. They feel the power of saying, no, I'm so sick of this little man. But that's not their right. They're being paid to serve. And that's the sadness in the world, that when we don't have enough relationships in life is not really the problem, that people at certain stages of life decide they're no longer going to make any new relationships. And that puts them at risk. Now, there are other people on the opposite side of the spectrum. These are people that are social butterflies that can literally make a relationship in a moment's notice, but they have great difficulty maintaining relationships because of the power imposition that it puts them in. That they either have to be responsible for their interactions with that individual for the long term, or they have to practically learn how to manage themselves in a long way. Now, there's a lovely gal I met through one networking group, and I really like this woman. She is a beautiful souled girl, and she just would glow all the time. And I complimented her on this, and it wasn't that I was attracted to her physically. It's just that I could see the glow about her, and she said, you know, it's because I love God that I have this glow. And I believed her. And in truth, she had an interesting dynamic in her relationship because I would have never predicted her to be married to a school teacher, an educator, or anything like that. And she literally was more the breadwinner of that household. But openly, she has not really lost anything in life. She has a family, she has children, but is she truly happy? And the real question is, did she really pick the right man for herself? May or may not be the choice for me to talk about, but I have to say, when people are not happy in their lives, they're always looking for something else. And that's the truth. Now, there are people who job hunt. They stay with the job for 2 years, and then they go looking for something else because they know the rules, that they have to produce a life for themselves, and especially after divorce, when they have children to look after, colleges to plan for, and other aspects of life, that they need someone who will love them until the day they're dead. And I hate to be that blunt and practical about it, but that is the truth. So when we're talking about these in real practical aspects, you have to take a look at your relationships that you're in. Who amongst your relationships will literally fight for you until the literal death of their life to protect you from all harm, to care for you in your old age, to wipe your nose, to wipe your ass, and to do whatever else has to be done in order to make sure that you go on in life? My mother sort of started to grasp that at the tail stages of my father's passing. That she was realizing that she was losing her husband. She was angry about it for the longest time. She was pissed as hell that he kept following him, like, he can't help it. So I bought him a crash helmet to make sure that he wouldn't kill his beautiful brain, even though the rest of his body was failing. He literally couldn't hold his bladder, and I get pissed off at these bathrooms that are all automated. When you're dealing with a senior citizen, you cannot handle fighting with a damn washing sink that will just go on whenever the heck it feels like it. I get tired of this automation. I certainly don't like the idea that there's a toilet being flushed for me. I don't like the fact that there's a camera in some of these toilets, because that means my butt is in someone else's video capabilities, and I don't like that at all. Now, have you ever thought about that? How does it know to flush? Is it just a sensor moving? I swear in Walmart there's a video camera in that toilet, and I'd love to pull it apart to see for sure. Because there are people that do immoral, illicit things in bathrooms is absolutely true, but it does not give that company the right to do anything else with that videotape. Now, in life, we have to talk about things that are funny. We have to talk about things that are outrageous. We have to talk about the realities of the world today, that people do use these cameras to voyeur on people's lives, to steal their property, do all sorts of things. And I know that when I fell asleep with my narcolepsy inside Walmart, I lost literally legal documentation out of my bags. I know when I fell asleep in a Hardee's, I lost a life insurance policy. Now, who the hell gives someone the right to not be the right kind of employee in a company to allow someone who's a total stranger to walk up to someone who's fallen asleep and get into their belongings, or that employee themselves be allowed to do that by any other manager or any other employee? That police should have been called in that second's moment, because that person didn't come in with that individual. There's no way to prove that they know that individual, and there certainly is no way to say that they have the right to take one thing from a person's property, bags, or anything else. Now, when we talk like this, what are we talking about? We're talking about federal laws. We're talking about safety of people's lives. We're talking about our right to privacy, our right to property, or our right to privilege, our right to practically just about everything in life. But when we talk like this, what does it make sense to people for? It's hard to say. Now, I like to do this journalistic style of freestyle journalism. It literally says, keep up if you can, and if you can't, sorry to hear that. But it means you don't know and don't have the ability to predict where I might be going, literally, with my conversation. But let's get back to practically where we began. Then in life, we have moments of time to tell someone how much we literally love them. We have moments of time, and sometimes we miss them because we don't feel in our soul at that moment that it's the right moment. It might actually be the right moment, but we're fearful. We don't know what to say. When I was asked by a little woman who was sitting on my counter in my kitchen in Carmel in the Arts and Design District, where did I see I was going to be myself in 5 years, the only thing that my soul was ready to scream was, married to you. But I literally thought, I can't say that because my significant other is upstairs, her significant other is across town, and even though I've been told she's going to get a divorce, how am I supposed to handle that? And at that moment in time, she might have actually literally been in the fight of divorce, and I didn't know that that was the right thing to say. Now, much time has passed, a lot of lost life and opportunity has gone by, but how does a man produce a new life when he's madly in love with someone who is so busy in her life that she can't respond to a marriage proposal? I literally have asked this woman now 4 times, technically 4 times, and not once has she responded to my proposal. And I have to sit there and think, did technology interfere with my opportunity to not only talk to her by telephone, but to produce a meeting in which to propose, but absolutely, did someone interfere with my right to send her that proposal by modifying my rights in technology, which I'm personally paying for every single month or annually by my own email capabilities, my own technology, or these companies that allow us free access, these free tools that literally they utilize to social engineer our lives, to determine what we're looking for, to shop for, and all that sort of stuff. And how many of you are annoyed to hell that when you log out of your Explorer, you find yourself opening it up and things are reopened again that you've logged out of? You see, that's a violation of rights. Now, I'm talking about a lot of things today, but I'm practically talking about the marriage proposal. How many men would like to stand in front of the girl that they love and simply say, these are the little reasons why I love you, this is what I want to have happen in our life, and openly, if you don't get on the damn page with me, God might just piss all over your life in a way that you can't get out of. Now, how practical is that in terms of a proposal? I can't say. It's sort of comical. But in truth, there are people who make the wrong decision twice in life, and then they're suffering for it when they're old age. You see, a man who loves you will also love your children. A man who longs to see you will also make sure that the children have something to look at when they're meeting them. And frankly, I've had a woman bring her children to my house, and I literally put games in front of that child so the child could be content and I could talk to that woman. But that's what a practical, education-oriented man does. I've trained a lot of kids in my life, and I don't need someone to tell me how to understand a child is not true. I make some mistakes, sure. But practically, when parents don't do their right, proper parenting, it makes it hard on the educators. Educators have some capability to make a difference when they're in the one-on-one setting, because a relationship is totally reliant on one person with another. I have some loving kids who used to be in my program who do even still connect with me on LinkedIn. But that's my lawful right to keep up on their lives, to see how wonderful they're doing in life, and to make sure they're still going on wonderfully in their own way. And I have some wonderful kids who had great gifts, and I hope they're really practicing those little talents that the Lord put in them. In life, we have to look at who is going to love us, but also provide for our children. You see, a man who's taking over as a step-parent has to be ready for that capability. He can't just say, oh, that's the father's responsibility, or that's not my job. Now, when a man took over my role to my Japanese spouse, I literally said to him, are you going to provide for my stepson in your old age? Are you going to provide him your information, your resources? Now, that man supposedly spoke enough English to mock me through Facebook and keep interfering with my right to talk to my old spouse to make sure my son is okay and all that sort of things, but he didn't exactly respond. Now, I could have said it to him in Japanese, but I'm not going to play that game. He should not be talking to me at all. I should also not have siblings talking to my old spouse without my permission. That is absolutely true, but they violate rights all day long, and I get tired of it. Now, in life, we have moments of time to make interesting type of audio casts, things that people want to listen to, things that people want to laugh at, things that people want to understand. Making a life worth living and a retirement worth having is really about the people in our lives. And as I sit here and the room gets a little noisier because of this men's group of fellowship that I'm sitting near, I'm reminded of how important relationships are. You see, later in life is not the problem. It's the middle ages, the middle years of our life, the 40s to 50-somethings areas, almost to 60, that we have to continue to produce for our life. We have to continue to produce resources that will allow us to live into our retirement. We can't just rely on inheritance, because money can be stolen by people. Police officers can manhandle a person's liabilities. And practically, there are people who literally will steal from storage units. I know this for an absolute fact because it's been happening to me for some time now. That person is illegally and monstrously going through my belongings, ruining property, taking my paperwork that I carefully and lovingly set aside for my own self and destroying it, and putting it back in my property bags as I travel when I fall asleep. I don't know what kind of a monster does that, but I really feel it's an illness in them. It's not an illness in me to make the mental note, but I just get tired of it, so I don't talk about it that much. I'm just like, okay, whatever, play your stupid little game, God's going to kill your life, and he's going to put you in hell. You see, people sort of forget that reality, that when they die, they go someplace, and whether they're an atheist or not does not prevent them from either going to heaven or hell. I have to say it that way. I have to say it because I can produce an energy of the Lord is not true. The Lord produces that energy, and I can show it to people, but they have to be willing to believe that the Lord can do those things. And they have to decide. When we hear these stories of heaven is real and all these predictable type of movies that show how God works and all this sort of stuff, is that just people making up a lie about what heaven is like? Or are those people actually people who died, went to heaven, came back, and looked at things? I have a dear friend who I love very much. I love her very much because we had such wonderful talks. She's not someone I have any personal interest in the way that men have interest in women, but she is a lovely gal who taught me so much about God that I practically just love her for that aspect. Her name is not important, but she literally died. She told me about how she hovered over her body in the hospital and looked down and could see her family around her. Now, that was an amazing story. I believe her because she's an honest woman. She's not a liar. She's not a manipulator. She is honest to a fault, and I love that about her. There are other people who lie and manipulate and steal. There are other people who think they have the right to take people's property, that they somehow have the right to pilfer. There are also people who lie about doing things like payment of things, causing people to lose their entire life's value. And those people are monsters, absolute monsters. Now, how do you protect someone from people like that? We teach proper liabilities in the world, and we're not doing that in school. We are not producing children who understand liabilities, legalities, or the law of America. We are not teaching the infidels who come here those laws either. We're not requiring them to go to school at all, is somewhat true, and they come in and they steal our property, they steal our homes, they lie about their legalities of being here, and I'm tired of that. Because I had to work especially hard to bring someone I loved into the country lawfully, legally, and soundly in a way that made us all legal. And that's annoying that other people get here illegally. It cost me fortunes, not at all. It cost me relationships a little bit. But I had a father who loved me, who supported me, who understood my love of someone, and simply said, I will honor you by supporting you in some ways. I have siblings who are vehemently angry about how my father chose to support me, and I think, whose lot is theirs to talk about? Now, there is a lot in the Bible, and I'll let you look him up on your own, but in truth, Lot is who handled things correctly. In life, we have lots. The lots are our parents' choosing. When I put my property aside in my storage unit, I put it aside for my children in my soul. Now, let's think that through. These children may not be my children of my loins. These children may be people that I choose to give my property to help their life to have better enjoyment of their life. My property is for me to bequeath to the woman I love, whose name I don't have to reveal to anyone other than the legal people who handle my financial aspects of my life. And if she doesn't want the money, that's her own foolishness. Because in life, we have to practically be looked after in old age, and if someone passes through natural means and causes, then we should be honored the fact that someone literally predicted their own passing to the point that they were ready and willing and able to say, all that I have, all that I'm worth, all that I've been able to invest in my own life since my earliest of times of birth, of literally being 0 years old, is yours. Because why? Because I love you more than life itself. Now let's really talk about what life insurance policies say. They literally say, if I pass, I love you more than life itself. The value of my worth goes to you. Now my father knew how to put things together as absolute truth. My mother doesn't get how important that was sometimes. She also doesn't get how laws work in her old age. She thinks that her act as a mother is her right under the law of what, I don't know. There are people in the family who don't understand what the laws are. There are police who don't get that federal law applies to them too. And openly, when I talk like this, I put myself at risk. But I want this world in America to change. I want the laws of our land to protect people's lawful rights to three things only. Personhood, that my body is mine and you will not touch me, you will not do one thing to any record of mine without my say-so, period. Two, I want people to understand that property means anything literally one person possesses, owns, purchased, received as a gift, and that property is literally theirs until they die, unless they choose to do something else with it. And finally, paperwork. Our legal documentation is not for some little moron to pilfer through, to steal, to look through, to look over, to manhandle, to manage, to lie about their rights to it. And that's something that federal law totally protects. You see, when I make this idea of Mark's law, I'm talking about the mark on our life. The mark on our life, not only from God in heaven, but the mark on our life that we leave on other people's lives. You see, when people start to leave marks on people's lives, it's when people start to shift, change, grow, develop, and develop a soul that's beyond their capabilities of controlling is not true, that their ability to go on in life moves so much higher in the law of the world because they had someone who loved them enough in those moments in time. And we don't mean love, passion, that sort of thing, but just gentle care, loving caress, good hugs, whatever it might be, to help a person heal, to help a person be fuller of person, and openly to go on in life in a way that makes them feel whole in the soul that the Lord has provided them. And that's something that pastors are sort of forgetting, that when they're preaching from the pulpit, they're not doing a lot these days. I've been to a lot of sermons, and I'm like, what the hell is this man talking about? I don't hear one thing about the way that God loves people. I don't hear one thing about how we utilize that love in our lives. And I certainly don't hear one thing in the world about how to handle difficult people or difficult situations. It's like they're too afraid to say the truth. Then in a difficult situation, you go and you talk to that person. If that doesn't work, then you pick someone who is mutually free of any emotions about the situation at all and simply ask them to sit as a mediator. We do this all the time in divorce, but sometimes it's ridiculous, the people we choose to help us fight in our divorce, because sometimes those stupid things last a lifetime. It's ridiculousness. It's immaturity on the part of a man to not honor his first wife, and it's foolishness on the part of a girl to keep pursuing a man who doesn't love her anymore. And in truth, that is how I feel. Now, in life, I had a woman who openly called me from a foreign country and said, please come, please be with me. And I had to realize that as much as I wanted to literally go, I needed to make sure that the person in my life into my old age would actually look after me well when I was ill or when I was passing. And that was the hardest part of letting go of that relationship. That in my life, I spent 20 years of my life loving someone who I loved dearly, completely, gave up a lot of my inheritance and my life for. But in the end, she was not totally who God had planned for me. God had her planned for me to help me to learn how to be a better man. And I know that for a fact in my soul. The one God planned for me came in on a prayer and has left because other people interfered with her ability to make her own choices about whether or not she was going to fall for a little fellow like me. And the truth is, that was illegal and immoral in the house of the Lord. Now, in life, we have moments of time to make interesting audio files. I hope this has been kind of a whirlwind tour of life. I hope this has been kind of a predictive opportunity for you to look at your own life and think, how much of what he's talking about actually applies in my own little gifted life? That we have moments of time to gift people opportunities. We have moments of time to do something to help someone. We have moments of time to lend money. We have moments of time to pay for things. We have moments of time to transfer any type of wealth we have that we put into stupid-ass purchases, like coffee every single day for $6 to $8 a pop, and put it into someone whose life is falling apart. We have people in the world who have power beyond belief, yet they let people struggle because they're too afraid to get involved, or they don't know how to get involved because they're not listening well enough. Sure, they don't have their little responsibility to do things, but what if they could? What if one little moment in time, one little helping comment, could change the face of a person's life forever? That's what we're talking about here, people, is how do you change the life of a person without him destroying the plans that the Lord has made for their life, their loves, their future, their money, their every aspect of being in the house of God, who put the soul in the human being that was imparted to the parents, who produced a child, who literally then reared them into adulthood to make them into the individual that they are today. That's the truth, that parents rear children, but they are not fully accountable for their education. The rest of the world participates in that. Jobs do, employers do, difficult situations do, people do, all sorts of things create a person's mind, heart, and soul, and why they're passionate about the people they love, those that they care for, and how they will look after those they adore until the time they die. Now, this has been Blake Ensign talking about a lot of different things in one little audio cast, hoping that the persons that the Lord put on this path to listen to this particular issue, this particular version, this particular edition of my audio cast will make a difference in other people's lives. Thanks for listening.